Okay, in the first part of transport layer HTTP protocol, we have discussed about HTTP packet, HTTP features, and even we have compared HTTP protocol with TCP. Once again, here we will discuss related with HTTP transmission process, that is process to process communication, how it is carried out in the form of HTTP connection, which is referred as HTTP association. As we know that HTTP is a protocol which combines best features of UDP and TCP. HTTP is a reliable message-oriented protocol. This is going to preserve message boundaries, at the same time detects lost data, duplicate data and out-of-order data. It also has congestion control and flow control mechanism, and all this is carried out under HTTP association. So, as a part of this second session based on HTTP, we will discuss HTTP connection, that is HTTP association, association establishment, cookies and data transfer. So, as far as HTTP association is considered, so since it is a connection oriented protocol, with the help of chunks, it is going to perform the process to process communication. There are already we mentioned different chunks like data initialization, acknowledgement related, then abort, shutdown, or even there is very special like cookies related, that is cookie acknowledgement, which is very important in case of association establishment. So all these chunks are helping HTTP. Association establishment in HTTP requires four-way handshaking. So in this particular process, normally client wants to establish the connection or association with another process, and server using HTTP as a transport layer protocol. Similar to TCP, HTTP server needs to be prepared to receive any association, that is with the help of passive open and association establishment initiated with the active open by client. Now we'll go through that. So this is something which you have to remember, that is connection in HTTP is called association. No other chunk is allowed in a packet carrying an initialization or initialization acknowledgement chunk, and a cookie echo or cookie acknowledgement chunk can carry data chunks. So as I mentioned, there is a four-way handshaking. So as you can see in the figure, so step by step it is carried out. The client sends the first packet which contains initialization chunk. You can see in the figure that blue color. So it is an initialization chunk. Then in the second step, the server sends the second packet which contains initialization chunk. The client sends third packet, that is including cookie echo chunk. You can see in the figure, a blue and yellow mixed packet. So it is a cookie echo chunk. This is very simple chunk that echoes without change. The cookie sent by server HTTP allows the inclusion of data chunk in this packet. So that is shown. The server sends the fourth packet, so which is nothing but the cookie acknowledgement chunk, that acknowledges the receipt of cookie echo chunk. HTTP allows the inclusion of data chunk with this packet also. So you can see in the figure how it is processing. So from client to server, this is called four-way handshaking. In general, as far as cookies are considered, so with TCP, generally attacker can flood a TCP server with huge number of sync segments using forged IP addresses. Each time server receives a sync segment, it setups the state table, allocate other resource while waiting for the next segment to arrive. In case of HTTP, we have a strategy to prevent this type of attack. Because in case of TCP, server may collapse due to exhaustion of resources. So it's going to exhaust altogether. The strategy in HTTP is to postpone the allocation of resources until the reception of third packet. That is, when the IP address of the sender is verified, the information received in the first packet must somehow be saved until third packet arrives. But if the server saved the information that would require the allocation of resources, there is a sort of a dilemma. The solution is to pack the information and send it back to the client. This is called as generating a cookie. Cookie is sent with the second packet to the address received in the first packet. If the sender of the first packet is an attacker, the server never receives the third packet. The cookie is lost and no resources are allocated. The only effort for the server is baking the cookie as if. And in the second situation, if the sender of the first packet is an honest client that needs to make connection, it receives the second packet with the cookie. It sends a packet with the cookie with no changes. The server receives the third packet and knows that it has come from the honest client because the cookie that the sender has sent there has been acknowledged and the server can now allocate the resources. So this is the kind of a simple strategy. This works if no entity can eat a cookie baked by the server. To guarantee, the server creates digest from the information and its own secret key, which we have in cryptography we mentioned in that if you refer that presentation, you will find there the information and the digest together make the cookie, which is sent to the client in the second packet. When the cookie is returned in the third packet, the server calculates the digest from the information. If the digest matches the one that is sent, then the cookie has not been changed by the other entity. The data transfer as a whole purpose of an association is between two ends, and after the association is established, bidirectional data transfer can take place. The client and the server can both send data. Like TCP, SCTP also supports piggybacking. Now here you can go through the simple data transfer. You can see there is a little difference. In TCP receives message from process as in stream by bytes without recognizing any boundary between them. The process may insert some boundaries for its peer use, but TCP treats that as a part of text. In case of SCTP, recognizes and maintains the boundaries. Each message confirming from the process is treated as one unit and inserted into data chunk unless it is fragmented. So in the sense, SCTP is like UDP with one big advantage that data chunks are related to each other. The message received from process becomes a data chunk or chunk, and if fragmented by adding data chunk header to the message, each data chunk formed by message or fragment by message has one TSN. So that is a sequence number, and we need to remember that data chunks are they are using TSNs, and only data chunks are acknowledged by SACK chunk. So SCTP only data chunks consume TSN. Data chunks are the only chunks that are acknowledged. Now in the figure of data transfer, you can see the client sends the first packet carrying two data chunks with TSN 7105 and 7106. See upper two blue packets. Then the client sends the second packet carrying two data chunks with TSN 7107 and 7108. So 5, 6, 7 and 8. The third packet is from the server. It contains SACK chunk. Need to acknowledge the receipt of data chunk from the client contrary to TCP. SCTP acknowledges the last in order TSN received, not the next expected. This is difference. So TSN you can see there. The third packet also includes the first data chunk from the server with TSN 121. After a while, server sends another packet carrying the last data chunk with TSN 122, but it does not include SACK chunk in the packet because the last data chunk received from the client was already acknowledged. Finally, the client sends a packet that contains SACK chunk acknowledging the receipt of last two data chunks from the server. So that is 122. You can see here the multi-homing data transfer is there. So It allows both ends to define multiple IP addresses for communication. Only one of these addresses can be defined as primary address. The rest are alternative addresses. The primary address is defined during association establishment. The interesting point is that the primary address of an end is determined by the other end. This is something very special. The source defines the primary address for destination. And in case of multi-stream delivery as far as considered, one interesting feature of HTTP is the distinction between data transfer and data delivery. HTTP uses TSN number to handle data transfer movement of data chunks between the source and destination. The delivery of the data chunks is controlled by SI and SSN. HTTP can support multiple streams, which means that the sender process can define different streams and a message can belong to one of these streams. Each stream is assigned a stream identifier, which is uniquely defining that stream. The fragmentation as far as considered, so although HTTP shares this term with IP, fragmentation in IP and in HTTP belongs to different levels. The former in IP is carried out at the network layer, and this HTTP fragmentation is carried out at transport layer. This you have to remember. HTTP preserves the boundaries of the message from process to process when creating data chunk from a message if the size of the message does not exceed the MTU of the path. The size of an IP datagram carrying a message can be determined by adding the size of the message in the bytes to the four overheads: data chunk header, necessary SACK chunk, HTTP general header, and IP header. If the total size exceeds the MTU, the message needs to be fragmented. So this you have to remember in the form of fragmentation. As far as association termination is considered, here you remember that HTTP only data chunk consumes TSN. Data chunks are the only chunks that are acknowledged, and the acknowledgement in HTTP defines the cumulative TSN, the TSN of the last data chunk received in the order. These things you have to remember. Association termination is carried out in this fashion. You can see HTTP does not allow a closed situation. If one end closes the association, the other end must stop sending new data. If any data are left over in the queue of the recipient of the termination request, they are sent and association is closed. Association termination is using three packets. Here you can see the figure shows the case in which termination is initiated by the client. It can also be initiated by server. There can be several scenarios of association termination, and you can have shutdown then from client, or shutdown acknowledgement from server, and a shutdown complete from the client once again. Now, as far as flow control is considered, in HTTP, similar to TCP, we need to deal with one unit of data, like in TCP, the byte. But HTTP, it has to handle two units of data, that is byte and the chunk. The value of RWND and CWND are expressed in the bytes. The value of TSN and acknowledgements are expressed in the chunks. Now, you can have some unrealistic assumptions, like there is never congestion in the network and the network is error-free. So this is a kind of unrealistic assumption. And we assume that CWND is infinite and no packet is lost or delayed or arrives out of order. Also, we can assume that data transfer is unidirectional, and we correct our unrealistic assumptions. For that, something we need to deal with flow control. So here you can see the receiver side. The receiver has one buffer and three variables. You can see. So there is the first variable is TSN, holds the last TSN received, that is cumulative TSN, CUM TSN. The second variable holds the available buffer size, you can see, that is in the form of win size. And the third variable holds the last accumulative acknowledgement, that is last ACK, that yellow color 26, 1020, three figures. So these are three variables. When site receives a data chunk, it stores it at the end of the buffer and subtract the size of the chunk from the win size. The TSN number of the chunk is stored in the cumulative TSN variable. When the process reads the chunk, it removes it from the queue and adds the size of the removed chunk to win size, recycling. You can see here. So that 22, 23, 24, 25, 26. So 26 is there, the process is there, and again it is updated. Recycling is done. When the receiver decides to send SACK, it checks the value of last SACK. If it is less than cumulative chunk, that is, see here, if it is 20, say for example, it sent SACK with cumulative TSN number equal to cumulative TSN. It also includes the value of win size and advertised window, that is nothing but the advertised window size. Now, as far as sender site is considered, here you can see the buffer holds the chunks produced by the process, sending queue from process and outstanding chunks. So here also you can see the first variable CURTSN. So refers to the next chunk to be sent, current one. All chunks in the queue with the TSN less than this value have been sent but not acknowledged. So the figure you can see color difference up to 37 and 36 onwards. Then the second variable RWND holds the last value advertised by the receiver in bytes. And the third variable in transit holds the number of bytes in transit bytes sent, but not yet acknowledged. Now the process you can just realize. Here it is. The chunk pointed by the CURTSN can be sent if the size of the data is less than or equal to quantity in the case of RWND in transit. After sending the chunk, the value of CURTSN is incremented by 1 and now points to next chunk to be sent. The value of in transit is incremented by the size of data in the transmitted chunk. And when SACK is received, then the chunk with TSN less than or equal to cumulative TSN in SACK are removed from the queue and discarded. Then the second does not have to worry about them anymore. The value of transit is reduced by 1 and the total size of discarded chunks, the value of RWND is updated with the value advertised in the SACK window. Now, as far as flow control is considered, you can see the mechanism. This is very straightforward. At the start, the value of RWND at the sender side and the value of win size at the receiver side, both first row. So 2000 RWND yellow color, 1 2000 0, you can see, and other side, that is win size, 2000 2000. So originally there are four messages in the sender queue. The sender sends one data link data chunk and adds the number of bytes, so that is 1000 in the in transit variable. After a while, the sender checks the difference between the RWND and in transit, which is 1000 bytes. So it can send another data chunk. The difference between the two variables is now 0. So when both of them are going to become 2000, 2000, that is RWND and in transit, the difference is 0 and no more data chunks can be sent. After a while, SACK arrives. So you can see SACK with RWND 0. SACK 2, it is mentioned yellow color from the receiver side, and it is going to acknowledge data chunks 1 and 2. The two chunks are removed from the queue. The value of in transit is now 0. The SACK advertised in the receiver window of value is 0, so which makes the sender update RWND to once again 0. Now the sender is blocked, it cannot send any data chunk. After receiver side, the queue is empty. At the beginning, after the first data chunk is received, now then there is one message in the queue and the value of cumulative TSN is made 1, and the value of win size is reduced then to 1000 because the first message occupies 1000 bytes. And after second data chunk is received, the value of window size is 0 and cumulative TSN is 2. So there you can see second yellow, third yellow in that. Then the receiver is required to send SACK with the cumulative TSN of 2, and after the first SSCK was sent, the process reads the two messages, which means that there is no room in the queue. The receiver advertises the situation with SSCK to allow the sender to send more data chunks. So this can be just understood from the figure. Now the error control, as far as consider in the receiver side, you can see here the simple thing that it uses SSCK chunk to report the state of the receiver buffer to the sender. Receiver stores all chunks that have arrived in the queue, including out of order ones. So here you can see. Then the last acknowledgement sent was for data chunk 20. You can see there last yellow variable, cumulative TSN, win size and last acknowledgement. It is 20. Chunks 21 to 23 have been received in order. The first out of order block contains chunks 26, 27 and 28. The second out of order contains chunks 31 to 34. In the figure you can see. The variable holds the value of cumulative TSN. The array of variables keeps track of beginning at the end of each block and what is out of order. So here you can see what is out of order is mentioned in that array. The array variable holds the duplicate chunks received. There is no need for storing duplicate chunks in the queue. The figure you can see SSCK chunk that will be sent to report the receiver state of the receiver to the sender, and the TSN number for out of order chunks are relative offsets to cumulative TSN. So 23 is just it is showing. Now you can see in the sender site what is happening. So here sender queue holds chunks 23 to 40. The chunks 23 to 36 have already been sent but not acknowledged. They are outstanding chunks. The current TSN points to the next chunk to be sent, 37. So here, say assuming that each chunk is 100 bytes, this means that 1400 bytes, that is 1400 bytes of data from chunks 23 to 36 is in transit. The sender at this moment has retransmission queue. When the packet is sent, the retransmission timer starts for the packet, all data chunks in the packet. Here you can have the single timer in the entire association, but there may be a tradition one timer for each packet for the simplification purpose. Conventionally it is done. The retransmission timer for packet expires or four duplicate SSCKs arrives that declare packets are missing. So the chunks are considered lost rather than outstanding, and the chunk in the retransmission queue have a priority. So you can have once again that after timer is expired, retransmission of the chunks. The chunk 21, from the 21 itself, it is in the retransmission queue because of intermediate misinterpretation. Sending data chunks at the end of the packet, there are data chunks in the sending queue with TSN greater than or equal to current TSN, or if there are data chunks in the retransmission queue, the retransmission queue has a priority. The total size of the data chunk or chunks included in the packet must not exceed RWND in transit, and the total size of the frame must not exceed the MTU size, which we already mentioned. The retransmission is to control the lost or discarded chunk. HTTP like TCP employs here two strategies. One is receiving four SSCKs with the same missing chunks, and another one is timers. So generating SSCK chunks, the general rules are followed similar to TCK, TCP SCK flag. Congestion control, as far as considered, here congestion in general HTTP is having slow start, so it is a kind of exponential increase. Congestion avoidance and congestion detection phases, like HTTP, HTTP is also having fast speed transmission and fast recovery kind of a strategy. So as far as process to process communication for SCTP, these are all the things. Thank you.